Hello, everyone, and welcome to the fifth episode of Who Needs a Film Critic? I'm your host, William Yelton, and today we will be talking about episode 5 of Squid Game. All right, let's jump right into the conversation about Squid Game Episode 5, entitled A Fair World. Jian and his team takes turns keeping guard through the night while the masked men encounter trouble with their co-conspirators. I think it's safe to say that out of all the episodes thus far, this episode seems to have the most going on. Not only are we following our main group of characters, but we are also following our cop as he gets deeper and deeper into his search for his brother, and our doctor, who is on the run throughout most of the episode. So let's start there. Did this panel like that this episode featured a multitude of storylines rather than just a typical episode, which focuses more on the core group of characters? What were your thoughts?
I absolutely loved it. I think that we needed this. We needed to expand the world. We need to understand how the game works. We need to understand what's going on behind the scenes here. And I think this was like a really good way of looking behind, you know, behind the curtain to really understand what the hell is going on here. You know, I'm very confused when the cop went into the stacks and was looking for his brother. I'm so confused. Didn't the guy just disappear? But he was looking at 2015. This episode left me very confused, but I really liked it. And I can't wait to hear like more answers to my questions.
On the contrary, I think I agree and almost disagree that about the 2015 thing. My suspicion when he flipped the 2015 thing with him disappearing is, you know, he might be part of like the higher ups or like the game people, the gamesman people. And, you know, if you win, you go on production. Like,
oh, that's cool.
And, you know, because he's like a lifer now and he won money. So I think he's probably involved. And that's what my suspicion is. Obviously, my very biased doctor take on this, like when we kind of unearth what happened with the doctor, yeah, he kind of just died like super fast, but he was really involved in opening our eyes to what's really going on behind the Squid Game. I think that was the first time where we kind of got a clear picture. Like when he was harvesting the eyes in the previous episode, I had no idea what he was doing with the eyes. But the funny thing is when he was actually being utilized for that organ harvesting and the cop kind of segued into that show, it was really, I knew he was done.
And I was wondering if the organ harvesting is actually a covert operation, unbeknownst to the headmaster. It seems to be an underground operation.
But the headmaster seemed to know about it. He said, I don't care what you do with the organs. You can sell them or eat them. I don't care. How did the headmaster know about this?
I think he knows everything that goes on. And I just think it didn't affect his game, you know, so I think he let it happen. But when he found out they were feeding him clues, that's when he was like, no, I don't think so. We play on an even playing field here, which you got to respect. You know what I mean? Even though it's there's rules. You can break some, but you're not breaking this one.
While we're on that subject, you have cued us in right to the first scene.
This is the most important thing. It's equality. In this game, everyone is equality.
This one's...
'Cause
it's like it's just interesting how like the game master basically is like branding this as like an altruistic thing, like yo, like this is fairness here, you know what I mean? And it's almost like that's the redeeming factor in literally every other thing that's like fucked up about this. Or like, all right, but like look, this shit is fair. And I mean, it's like very much a metaphor for, I think, like capitalism in the world, right? It's like branded as this like equal thing, right? The free market, everybody gets a fair shot at playing, you know. But you know, in the reality of things, it's really gruesome and still not fucking fair.
I also find it interesting that the game master won't take the life of a player, but he will take the life of his workers.
And why do you think that is, Jen? Continue that thought.
I think it goes back to him wanting everything to be fair, but like I guess that's a great question. I really don't know. Either it's that he has the life of all his workers in his hands and they're responsible for the gamers, or that he just wants to keep it all fair. I really don't know.
And I never noticed it until Jen pointed that out. And now, you know, I mean, I was going back in different, you know, episodes, and I'm like, man, you're right. I didn't cue in on that. But yeah, it's weird.
I would like to, like, for instance, our doctor here, our resident doctor, the pediatrician, never gives the shots. It's always the nurses, because we want to trust the doctor. So we want to trust our game host, is why he's not killing people, and he leaves it to his minions to do it, so that everyone trusts him that he's the leader, just like the doctor.
Rachel, that's so true. I'm a pediatrician and I'm like, they're the bad guys, they're the nurses, they're giving you the shots, but I'm good.
Right.
I'll just laugh and like, hey, how are you, buddy? But then they send it to the nurse and they get a jab and you just hear, ah!
Could the game master guy be related to one of the players, or have some sort of relationship with the players? So I wonder if the front man or the leader has some sort of relationship where he can stand back and go, I didn't kill him, somebody else did, if they get caught.
Kim has officially been converted. She was the loudest voice saying, you guys are trying to make fetch happen and it's not happening. And now she's saying fetch.
Fetch is happening right now, because this episode kind of started me spiraling, going, maybe some of those conspiracy theories are right.
At the end of this episode, we get to the point where the cop gets down to the records and he's looking through the books, right? I don't feel like it's a coincidence that when he opens the first book, the first player that's shown is 002, not 001. Why did he skip 001? I feel like there's more to the fact that they opened at 002. We're not supposed to see something yet. And
old man watch.
Just going to say it.
So that's what I was going to say. I'm going back to my original theory, where I think the old man, and he might not be the front man, but he is somehow involved in production, per se.
I just wondered if anyone else thought it was strange when the cop got into the records room that nothing was digitized. He finds paper records and they were fairly current. It wasn't until I got to the big surprise for me was the list of winners from 1988 and realizing this game's been going on for a long time. And maybe that's why they didn't convert to computers somewhere along the line, but it just seemed out of place.
All right, we're going to transition now. So now let's talk about our core group as they act out the buddy system while standing guard. All the action of this episode took place kind of within the subplots that we just discussed about. But this episode seemed to make a deliberate choice to take a step back, and much like episode 2, focus more on our main characters' backstories and their relationships towards one another. So what were your thoughts of kind of these intimate conversations late at night between pairs of people who are on our core group of protagonists team?
You know, with them talking intimately with each other, I do believe that's going to foreshadow into gameplay or strategy in other games. So I like the intimacy that we got learning a little bit about each character opening up.
I felt that it was necessary because it showed some conversations between players that hadn't really had much interaction, like the main character and the pickpocket. It was more of an intimate scene where they like kind of started building their trust. But one thing that I just, the business school man, I can't stand him. And I see through him so much. Like, I know that when he was sitting with Ali, that, you know, Ali offered his corn, and at first, you know, he did take it, but then he split it. And I feel like that was just a moment for him to kind of build some trust with Ali, to get knowledge and to learn a little bit more about him. I don't think he's genuine. I think he's in it for the game and he knows what he wants to do. And I think it's just very apparent.
Cool. I want to focus on one scene in particular, and then we will discuss.
Oh. 무슨 생각을 그렇게 하나? 눈뜨고 자는 줄 알았어.
예전에 다니던 회사에서.
맞아. 10년 전쯤인가. 거기서 사람이 죽었지 않나?
Thoughts on that scene?
I actually kind of didn't realize it until we just watched it back. But one thing that really stood out to me, one line, was when the old man said, I feel like you were sleeping with your eyes open. And I just almost feel like that's like some sort of insight to like, hey, like you're not paying attention to what's in front of you. You're sleeping with your eyes open. But another thing, I think it just gave us more in-depth look at, unfortunately, how much of a coward the main character is. You know, if the flashback was represented correctly, you know, I feel like he was hiding while the other guys was out there fighting and getting beaten up. He was hidden and he was like, help me. And then back of the head. So I feel like it just really shows like he's not really down to help. He's going to hide. He's going to protect himself at all costs.
Which is, I think, a good strategy if you're you're in a game for, you know, for your life. Might be
not necessarily bad.
I don't blame him because I'd probably be doing the same.
I have a question. At what point do we think that Jian and number one, the old man, formed a legitimate, genuine relationship? Was it this episode? Was it the episode before? At what point do you really feel like they went from just acquaintances to something deeper than that?
I think meeting at that shop when they were let go in episode two.
But if Jen's theory is correct, and it was the moment in which they met out at that restaurant in episode two, why do you feel like in that moment, those two men formed that bond?
They formed that bond there because they were not in a game. You know, they could have walked past each other. They didn't have to have that conversation at all. They could have just gone about their merry way. But I think that that moment, definitely solidified a bond, but I honestly think it was the moment that they both went into the game and they saw each other, that they were like, honestly, we are here because of each other, because of our conversation.
In the Korean culture, the elders are really taken care of by the younger people. So everyone kind of respects him, even though he's the weakest person there.
I think to Rachel's point, you know, I think in Korea and in Asia in general, like elderly are revered. They're not like respected. They're not like, you know, looked up upon or whatever, like, you know, we do here. They're revered. They're almost like, you know, the elderly, you don't say no to whatever they say. That's Asian culture. There's no, you know, the difference between America. When I moved to America, it's like you put old people in nursing homes. That doesn't happen in Asia. You take care of them till they pass on to the next life, you know, like that's just culture, which is really a juxtaposition in this game, because the old man is really only liked by 456, by Gian. They're like, what are you picking an old man for, a strength challenge? Like, what are you thinking? So in Squid Game, he's a little bit more disrespected than the norm of, you know, Korean or Asian culture. But little do we know that he actually has the wisdom and the mastery that as he clearly showed in episode four of how to win a tug of war, which people in the heat of the moment clearly look past.
What I found interesting in the scene that you just showed was the fact that, remember, this old man couldn't remember his name at one point. You know, he lost his train of thought or his memory throughout the games up to this point, right? But yet, when they were sitting there talking to each other, how did the old man remember 10 years ago a factory strike that culminated with somebody dead, one person dead in a factory strike? Korea has more than one death in a decade. So the fact that this old man could recall that and be familiar with it makes me think two things. Maybe he's exaggerating his memory loss to look like a weaker person, or for pity or empathy or sympathy, whatever the case may be, or that he has short-term memory loss and recalls the things from years ago.
Watching the show more and more, that his memory comes back at the most convenient times.
Right.
Right. He just so happens to forget, but when it's convenient, he remembers things.
To comment on the old man's mental things, he does have a brain tumor. Whether that's true or not, we don't know. He's just anecdotally saying it. But you obviously would have, you know, mental, like, sorry, I'm getting amnesia, whether it's anterograde making new memories or retrograde remembering old memories, obviously being technical here. But I definitely think 1000% that he's playing it on a little bit more, but it's not 100%. When he passed urine when he was sleeping, I think that's definitely, you know, his bladder just giving out and not being able to control it because of the tumor's health or whatever. But certainly, like, I think he knows he's a lot smarter than we think he is, for sure. And he's using that to his advantage, the old man. Mm-hmm.
And if he was putting on the P, then he is a method actor because he is committing to the role. But anyway, let's get to the review. Iconic. You guys sent me the ratings individually, secretively. So we will find out now what the collective score is. The score for episode 5 is 3.8, which puts this episode in second place, right behind the last episode, episode 4. All right, that concludes today's discussion on episode 5 of Squid Game. Tune in next time to see what this panel thinks of episode 6. And remember to like, share, and subscribe to the channel. We are also on the podcast app, so type "Who Needs a Film Critic" to get all the episodes downloaded straight to your phone. If you wish to join a future panel talking with me about another movie or television show, email me at whoneedsafilmcritic@gmail.com. That's it for now. Hope you have a good night.